Gundur branch of Secretary of Gundur branch of SARC of ICAI. I welcome everyone to this refresher course on DISA AT examination held jointly by 13 branches: Anantapur, Kadapa, Kakinada, Karimnagar, Warangal, Ongol, Rajamahendravaram, Tirupati, Vizag, Vijayawada, Nellur, Karnool, hosted by Gundur branch of SARC of ICAI. I think this is the first of its kind jointly organized by most of the branches in AP and Telangana, exclusively this refresher course. We thought this would be the best time to conduct this, because AT exams are going to be conducted after a long time by our ICAI, maybe mostly in the month of July. So we thought this would be the appropriate time, and we want everyone to make use of this opportunity. Now I welcome our chief guest, CA D. Prasanna Kumar sir, to this virtual webinar on our Gundur branch of SARC of ICAI. I also welcome our guest of honor, RCM and CA R. Chengal Reddy sir. And I also welcome today's speaker, CA Gopal Krishna Raju sir, to this webinar. I also recognize the presence of another speaker, Paul Jaikar sir. And I also recognize the presence of all other branch chairmen and managing committee members. Before handing over the proceedings, I would like to give the schedule of the course. We are going to start every day the session by 8:20 a.m. to 8:30 a.m. to have more time for the subject. On the first day, we have a session on information system audit process by CA Dr. Gopal Krishna Raju sir. And on the second day, that is on 15th of June, we have a CA Vittal Raj sir, who is going to take on governance and management of enterprise information technology, risk management, compliance and BCM section. On 16th of June, we have Dr. CA Paul Jaikar sir, who is going to take on system development, acquisition, implementation, maintenance, application and system audit. And on the fourth day of, that is on 17th of June, we have again Dr. Gopal Krishna Raju sir, who is going to take on information systems, operation and management. We have on 18th, that is on the fifth day, production of information assets by CA Dr. Paul Jaikar sir. And on the last day, that is on 19th of June, we have emerging technologies, lab manuals and case studies, again by Dr. CA Gopal Krishna Raju sir. Before this, I would like to inform you that we have created a WhatsApp group for members of this course. Whoever have not joined, we will share the link in the chat box. You can share, you can join in the same. And we will also place all the recorded videos in our Gundur branch YouTube channel. At a later time, you can view whenever you want. Thank you very much. Now I hand over the proceedings to our branch chairman, General Gadi Srinivas Rao sir.
Good morning. Thank you, Rahul Teja. Respected to his chief guest and the program director of the DISA AT Refresher Course Exam Oriented, CA D. Prasanna Kumar sir, and our godfather of the Gundur branch and the Central Council member. Welcome you, sir. Respected guest of honor, R. Chengal Reddy garu, RCM and executive member of the Gundur branch. And respected Dr. V. Gopal Krishna Raju sir, who is the backbone of this program. DKR, named as DKR Global Knowledge Repository, calling as Global Knowledge Repository. And my dear committee members and the respected all members present in the webinar, a warm good morning to one and all. On behalf of the 13 branches, we think it's a time to start a program like this. Why? Because 25% of the our community are depending upon the either it may be a revenue or contract or maybe statutory audits. And now, as per the new provisions of RBI regulatory, the DISA passing is must for doing all these concurrent or revenue or stock or that it may be in future it compulsory, it may be for statutory also. And due to Radhasarathi, Dr. D.K. Agar, we designed this plan. Everybody must use this for easily for passing the examination. And it's a privilege to host this program on behalf of all the 13 branches of AP, and all with the presence of the program director, Amikal D. Prasanna sir, as the APCM. You may is used to call for any purpose, you call me. So APCM or CM and the project branches, for all branches, we will call him as any purpose, call me person. So I invite all the members to this August gathering of DESA refresher 80 examination oriented course. Now I request the today's guest of honor, Chandra Reddy Garu, please address the gathering. Thank you. Over to Chandra Reddy sir.
Thank you, Chairman. Today's chief guest and our Honorable Central Council member, Program Director of today's program, CA Prasanna Kumar sir, plays a smiling person. First person of the branch, Guntur branch, CA Jonal Gadda Srinivas Rao garu. The other branch, chairmans, Rajamandri, Polu branches, the vice chairman Bhargavi, secretary Raviteja, the other Amarnath and the Raghunandan, immediate past chairman Manchukonda Srinivas Rao also joined today program. I think I saw him after a long time. The past chairman of Guntoru branch, the past treasurer of SIRCF ICA, today speaker, CA Dr. Gopalakrishna Raju, and the other speaker, CA Bal Cheikar, who is instrumental in organizing the today's refresher course on ISA, past chairman, senior members, my dear friends, the viewers of the virtual refresher course who joined today program, pleasant good morning to each one of you. I deem it a great privilege to welcome you all to this virtual webinar on refresher course on DESA exam hosted by the Guntur branch and organized by all the 13 branches from AP as well as Telangana states. Last year was an unprecedented year and brought an immense change in the world itself. The unparalleled challenges arising out of COVID-19 pandemic, which is unfolding, have impacted the professional and social levels altogether. However, the ICA continued its services without any interruption throughout the period of lockdown in technology to the maximum. ICA has always remained at the forefront of for taking technological initiatives despite all the challenges faced, restrictions on physical movement. ICA initiated various reforms to ensure that the professional is not only having inclusive growth, but also ensure that its members and students are kept updated on various professional matters, contemporary relevance. Technology is a transformational and it has impacted the practice of accounting and assurance, providing to be a game changer for the profession. Knowledge of existing and emerging digital technologies such as artificial intelligence, blockchain, robotics, automation, big data is extremely essential for the new age accountants. With respect to this DESA, as a DESA holder, we'll have an edge over traditional auditors. DESA has been recognized as one of the qualifications for systems auditors. Huge scope awaits for DESA qualified professionals. I think our chairman touched already the importance of the DESA, where in many government audits, ESA is mandatory, either ESA or CISA. If the none of the partners is having the DESA or the CISA qualification, then there is no eligibility for the concurrent audits also. DESA makes firm eligible to perform information system audit, as well as there are other requirements also based on sector where ESA audit is needed. DESA opens up opportunities to provide IT risk advisory and other IT related advisory to clients. Even DESA is helpful to cope up our office also with respect to the technological improvement. After a DESA certification, SEA can become faculty of even ITT and advanced ITT or ESA courses of ICA. It will be an additional income, we can say, for the member. Hope this refresher course organized by the, hosted by the Guntoru branch, organized by all the 13 branches of Telugu states, will help the participant in passing the AT exam. My compliments to the team of Guntoru branch. for hosting the program with eminent speakers. I think with this, I convey my sincere thanks to today's chief guest, CA Prasanna Kumar sir, who joined with this virtual web program. I think he will share all the initiatives at the head office level. And my sincere thanks to the learned speaker, GA, CA Gopalakrishna Raju, who helped our Guntur branch and also in arising the good speaker, eminent speakers for this refresher course on DISA AT exam. I convey my sincere thanks to all the team of Guntur branch for taking such a good initiative on organizing this refresher course on DISA. Thank you. I think I am part of this today program. I am also deem it a great privilege to be part of this Guntur branch in organizing this DISA refresher course on AT exam. Thank you very much. Over to the secretary.
Thank you. Thank you. Now I request the treasurer of the Guntur branch, Sutra Patapurnath, to please introduce today's guest of honor and program director, G. Prasanna Kumar, to the August gathering. Welcome to Nutra Party, please. Hello.
Sir, good morning, sir. Hello.
Yeah.
Good morning,
yes, sir.
Audible.
Yes, sir.
Audible.
Those who are not speaking, please keep it on mute so that we'll be able to hear everyone properly.
Yeah. Good morning to each and everyone who has participated in this seminar. It is my privilege to introduce the ever smiling person and Central Council member of our from our region, Andhra Pradesh, Sri D. C.A. D. Prasanna Kumar Garu. He is a Bachelor of Geology from Loyola College, Chennai. He joined a CA course in 1980 and became an associate member of the institute in the year 1984 and fellow member in the year 1990. Currently, he is the Central Council member of ICAI, only CCM from Andhra Pradesh. He is in many standing and non-standing committees of the council. His leadership qualities go back to his early school days, where he was the school people's leader and was president of botany and geology departments of Loyola College in 1979 and 80. He occupied several positions in the affairs of the institute at SIKASA branch and regional level. During his student days in CAA course, he had occupied the position of secretary and vice chairman of the Southern India Chartered Accountants Students Association in the early 80s. And made significant contribution to the student fraternity. He occupied all the positions in Visakhapatnam branch as treasurer, secretary, vice chairman, and chairman during the years 1998 to 2001. During his chairmanship, the Visakhapatnam branch received the best branch award for the first time. He was the member of Public Relations Committee of ICAI New Delhi for the term 2005 to 6. He later on became a member of Southern India Regional Council from the year 2007. In the year 2007-8, he was the secretary of SIRC and became vice chairman during the year 2012-13 and chairman of SIRC during the year 2013-14. During his chairmanship, SIRC received commendable performance certificate at All India level. He spoke and presented papers on bank audit, company law, professional ethics, union budget, etc. in seminars organized by the branches of ICAI. He is a keen follower of sports. CADA Prasanna Kumar himself is trained in many sports and a volleyball player. He held numerous positions in the sports. His wife is a homemaker and a sportswoman in her college days. He is blessed with a son and daughter. His daughter, a MS Electronics from New York University, and his son is a chartered accountant. With this brief profile, I am inviting today's chief guest and program director, CA D. Prasanna Kumar Garu, to continue his opening remarks. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Respected CA, Jonalakanda Srinivasrao Garu, the chairman of Guntur branch of SIRC-FICA, CA Changal Reddy, the regional council member and guest of honor for the program. CA Madhya Ravi Teja, the secretary of the host branch, and CA Paul Jaker, the speaker, one of the speakers, CA Gopal Krishna Raju, one of the speakers, and my chairman of many branches, because I'm not able to see everyone on the screen. So many branches represented all the host branches. My dear participants, good morning to all of you. It's my proud privilege today to participate in the inaugural session of the DISA Assessment Test Refresher Course, which is going to be held for a period of 6 days, 2 hours each, 12 hours refresher course. The host branch, Guntur branch, has done a commendable job here by coordinating with all the branches of Telugu states. We never call it Andhra Pradesh or Telangana, the Telugu Rashtralu, Telugu states. And particularly, as you know, when the number of members that will be interested branch-wise for participating in this program may be a little less, it is very difficult to organize a program at each branch level. So that is the background with which the Guntur branch thought that let us all join together. So it will get the best faculty, and all of you get in one platform, you'll be able to get the benefit out of the deliberations. And moreover, I can challenge anybody to say that, if any education program is conducted for any other profession, I'm not belittling anybody. Do you think that by 8:30, so close to 200 plus odd, professionals will assemble? I don't think so. Is only one thing is possible, only chartered accountants and chartered accountants alone. The so-called continuous professional education, it is true letter and spirit. If somebody is following, is only we should be proud of this one. Friends, in this program of 12 hours, you've got excellent faculty. So I got something special to talk about this faculty. We've got two doctors, chartered accountant doctors, CA Dr. Gopalakrishnan Raju. I'm very much attached with you because you're the president. I think all of you, some noise is coming. If you can mute, it will be nice if all of you can mute. Yeah. CA Gopalakrishnan Raju, he is son of my guru. His father, Gopal Rao, he was my teacher. So guru. And see, when you come to Paul Jaikar Garu, he is my guru himself. If at all we were to talk about one chartered accountant who knew technology in the early 80s, it was Paul Jaikar alone, nobody else. We didn't hear any other name at all. So we had one subject called systems audit and data processing. So I was a student. So the way he chose to teach, even today, if I say I'm little contributing many projects in the head office, I'm not a technology man. I don't know anything about Java, Giva, all those things I do not know. But I know what is required, from where I will get it. The flow chart, the process flow. I know even today, that's only the credit goes to, I remember Paul Jaikar every day. Even yesterday night also I had a meeting at 9 o'clock. It ended at 9 o'clock. I was still talking about the process flow, how to get the things done. That was the credit goes to Paul Jaikar Garu. He's excellent faculty. My Telugu vallu, iddaru Telugu baga telusina valle. So chala baga maatladtaru. So Vittal Raj Garu is equally an eminent personality. So I have chosen a very good faculty for this program. So when you come to the audit, already we see Changal Reddy has touched upon that at certain points. So traditional audit, where you use your brain. So that is a traditional audit. So that will continue, that should continue to be ever. It should be there. Only depending upon the technology is not going to serve. Technology should be enabler only, but that cannot take over the thought process of human being, particularly chartered accountant. So manual audit is yesterday's subject. And vouching and those traditional audit, what you do, that's all gone. This is yesterday, that's history only. But use of technology in every aspect of our practice is a must. Almost all compliances, in almost all enactments in the country, be it state enactments or central enactments, all are real time and online. So thereby, there's nothing, no paper movement, no physical movement will be there. Information technology, as all of us know, is a buzzword, and it plays a vital role and of paramount importance, not only in the general parlance, but also for chartered accountant practice. In this scenario, as all of you know, the Committee for Members in Practice of ICA, where I am the vice chairman, of course, I'm the vice chairman for the last 3 years. So we're coming with many audit tools. We have spoken in many forums also that we're coming with audit documentation tool, a data analytics tool, and practice management software, a digital library. These are the four initiatives we have taken the current year. Almost all the RFPs are over. Now the tendering process is going on. One that is over, I think, down the line, another 6 months to go, we'll have all these things in place, whereby it is going to equip every small and medium practitioners to use technology in the day-to-day audit. Not only tax audit, not only GST audit, of course, it may not be there now. It may come very soon. GST audit and either audit of general purpose audit and concurrent audit, bank audit, everywhere, that tool is going to be very useful. And we'll have a training sessions also for members, the once the tool is released. So that is going to be a game changer. So in the practice, in the day-to-day practice. Number two, these are the tools which you want to acquire individually for the type of the practice that we, the small and medium practitioners, have. It's very difficult to, when you make a cost-benefit analysis. That is the reason why head office has come into picture, so that, you know, it can be given free of charges to all the, you know, chartered accountant practice. Friends, as you know, both IT and IT, one IT is income tax, which we have been practicing the changes or dynamic Income Tax Act. But at least Income Tax Act, the major changes come due to the Finance Act only, Finance Bill and Finance Act. Once in a year later on, during the course of the small the changes may be there. When it comes to income information technology, is dynamically changing. Almost every day, it keeps changing. What was there in yesterday, today this new thing is coming into picture. That is the reason why the curriculum, what we have for the DISA, is going to be a dynamic thing. Periodically, we have to keep changing it so that we have to catch up with the times and technology. The continuous professional education is a must because of frequent changes that is happening, frequent improvement that is happening in information technology. So there's a mention about CISA also. Changal Reddy was mentioning CISA. So generally, CISA is a qualification which is internationally recognized. But of course, in India also it is recognized. All the regulators, Reserve Bank of India, CND, they also recognize CISA as a qualification. Generally, it said CISA has more relevant subjects in terms of application of the subject. But friends, my dear friends, please note that DISA curriculum has been revised in 2020. After revision of the curriculum, which is known as the new syllabus for the time being, that so-called new syllabus, which is almost equal to CISA. Almost equal to CISA. The type of learning you are giving, type of the eligibility, ET, AT, everything, assessment test is there. I think we are close to CISA. Down the line, DISA or CISA, it may not make any difference at all. This we want to take with regulators also. So after this, in the first test is going to begin very soon. So we have to take with regulator that we are no short of CISA. So, as Changal Reddy said, it's a must for empanel, no doubt, for, you know, maybe concurrent audit or, you know, CNDG audit or some other empanelments, it's a must. But at the same time, my dear friends, whether you get an audit or not, whether you get empaneled or not, but this is going to help you in your day-to-day practice also. No doubt, it is going to help in empanelment. It's also a must. We know the importance of empanelments also, but it is going to help us in our day-to-day practice also. So far, out of 130,000 chartered accountants in practice in the country, out of 330,000 chartered accountants, total number of chartered accountants, out of 127,000 chartered accountants have passed DISA. But over a period of time, over a period of, 20 years, the first DISA test was conducted in the year 2001. From there on, we have traveled a lot today. And so now, the ET pass, eligibility test pass, waiting to appear for the examination, 16,000. So I think it's a very good number. Going forward, and even the 16,000 members pass, we'll have a big bandwagon of close to 50,000 chartered accountants who are DISA qualified. So examinations, I know there's a lot of anxiety amongst the members, those who have passed ET, that when the examinations are going to be held. In sense, the last exam was held in the month of December 2019. For the last 18 months, we didn't have an examination at all. Normally, the examination is scheduled to be held in the month of June and December. This is the schedule, but we could not hold it for various reasons. Because even today, due to the pandemic, getting a, you know, sent, and last year also we had the pandemic, we wanted to have a center-based examination. So in the center-based examination, we need to go to the center. So we were not getting the centers at all. Those centers which are available were not up to the mark. That is the reason why, you know, time and again, we have put in our efforts to conduct the examination. We could not do it. Even now, almost every branch, even the Guntur branch also must have got a communication from the examination department to go and say, verify some examination centers. There's some exam centers are not opened at all. There are some examiners, they are telling that we will not be able to do it because, you know, lockdown situation, and they are not geared up for this one. And some examination centers, they have got less in number. There are got more numbers to be accommodated. Is not happening at all. That is the reason why some of the members have requested the examination committee to have a home-based examination. But in home-based examination is too early. I think too infancy stage where we will not be move to home-based examination for a qualification, post-qualification, recognized qualification like DISA at this point of time. Friends, actually, now the thinking is, as I told you, there are two syllabuses now, syllabi. One is old syllabus, and which was prior to 2020, and the new syllabus, the post-2020 revision. So these two syllabus, we have to conduct two examinations, at least for the next three attempts to go. The second thing is, in the given situation, should we wait for the normalcy to restore, or should we go for offline examination? Offline means it's only a same multiple choice questions only. It will be on the OMR sheet, the, you know, pencil mode. So what should be done? That decision will be taken today. By today evening, you will have some information whether you are going to have the offline examination or online examination. It is scheduled that in the month of August, early August, we are planning to conduct it. We have been having a lot of discussion for the last 1 week, 1 week back. So we are not thinking of this one. There are so many members who called us, but you know, called many Central Council members, including me, that, you know, something need to be done. Being examination committee member who took it at the priority, last 1 week's hectic activity is gone. Today, we're having a short meeting with the president, honorable president, where we'll take a decision where to go offline or online. If so, what is the date? So by today evening, you'll have something in hand. We have identified already 109 centers for conducting this particular examination. So this is the right time, friends, that you are having this particular course. And you know, the 12 hours course, so you learn very well in these 12 hours. I think the very soon you are going to have the examination, certainly in the month of August, early August. So where it is going to be very useful to you. So I, all of you, please learn well, because you've got very good faculty in the refresher course and prepare for the examination and appear for the examination in the August. I'm sure in the August month, when all of you appear, 100% results should be come. And I'm sure that, you know, you'll take the ICAE flag very high in the technology front also. With these few words, I compliment all the branch chairmen for joining together. All branches joining together for the excellent program organized by the Guntur branch. I compliment Guntur branch who has taken the lead. For Guntur branch is going to be yet another year of history, where they're going to come up with a good, beautiful building of their own. Already they have one. They are going to have a new one also. But for the corona, it should have been in another 4 or 5 months, we should have inaugurated. Maybe inauguration is not a big important thing, but things should move on. So it's a historical year. In this historical, doing such programs is a commendable thing. I thank them for giving me an opportunity. So thank you very much. So my pranams to my guru, Paul Jaikar Garu. So all the participants also, thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Now I request Raghunandan, Shilta Raghunandan, Sachikatha Chairman of the Guntur branch, to introduce today's speaker, the August gathering. Over to Shilta Raghunandan.
Good morning, members. Today's speaker, CA Dr. Gopalakrishna Raju Garu, is a practicing CA, registered insolvency professional and valuer. He's a partner in Mrs. K. Gopal Rao & Co. Chartered Accountants. Yeah, having a branch at Mumbai, Bangalore, Hyderabad, Madurai, Tiruchirappalli, Thiruvayur. He hails from a family of chartered accountants. His father, mother, younger brother, wife, all are practicing CAs. Sir had served consecutive 3 terms from 2010 to 2019 as SIRC Regional Council member. He had recently awarded doctorate in governance of GST in government sector by St. Mother Teresa University in Melbourne, Australia. He is an independent director's data bank, have qualified with distinction in the online proficiency self-assessment test conducted by Indian Institute of Corporate Affairs. He had various qualifications. He has a qualified valuer, IP exam. He is an associate member of Institute of Cost Accountants of India, associate member of ICSI, twin postgraduate diploma holder, MPhil, qualified ESOP, 8 NSCA certification, financial markets, etc. He had authored 2 books, Standard Costing and Variance Analysis for Professional Students, First Lessons in Information Technology for CA Students by Snow White Publishers, Mumbai. He is a seasoned speaker on information technology, finance and taxation, and visiting guest faculty for numerous institutions, corporates, B schools. He is a member of Institute of Directors, Bombay Chartered Accountants Society and Madras Management Association. He is nominated for various posts, Finance and Taxation Panel Member, FICCI, Tamil Nadu State Council, Chairman Valuation Standards Board, Valuation Standards Board, Institution of Valuers, Economic Board, Department of Commerce, etc. He is a passionate writer on technology and taxation in numerous journals and newspapers, columnist in Tamil Daily, The Hindu Tamil, weekly Tamil magazines, Nanayam, Vikatan, and Puthiya Talamurai Kalavi. As versatile speaker, GKR has addressed more than 500 plus meetings on GST to various forums, including professional bodies, Chamber of Commerce, Industry and Trade Associations in both English and Tamil. With this, I welcome today's speaker, Gopalakrishna Raju sir, to the address gathering. Over to you, sir.
Yeah. very respected Central Council member, CAD Prasanna Kumar Garu, and my chairman when I was the regional council member. Thank you very much, sir, for the nice words. Chairman of Guntur branch, CA J. Srinivas Rao Garu, and my good friend in regional council, CA Chengal Reddy, and esteemed the faculty member and my guru for today, if I'm able to share some of my thoughts on information system audit. Dr. Paul Jaker also equally he's like he's guru for CA Prasanna Kumar. He is also my revered guru for information systems, and many things practically I have learned and imbibed from Dr. Jaker and the secretary Ravi Teja and all the chairman of 13 branches and executive committee members, and more than 200 plus participants from various parts of southern region. So my hearty morning wishes to each and every one of you. This 13 is a very unique number, and we are able to see that because bringing all the 13 together by Guntur branch, I must definitely compliment JC. So the J is Jonal Gadda, and chairman of the Guntur branch. J is the 10th letter in alphabet, and C is the 3rd letter in alphabet. Maybe some magnetism is there. 10 plus 3 is 13. Good. Now, coming to today's topic, before I start, I must compliment CA Prasanna Kumar Garu for giving the introductory remarks and also encouraging all the participants that whether you are a participant of 2.0 or 3.0, even recently, last month, we are now in June, last month, May, the eligibility test was conducted. When the eligibility test was conducted, if you have gone through the respective pointers that was given, number one, those who have completed your professional training in 2.0 and professional training in 3.0, the application form is separately has to be filled up. And I'm sure Dr. Paul Jaker also will add more points with respect to this, that with respect to 2.1, 3.0, the syllabus is revamped in 2020, rightly pointed out by Prasanna Kumarji, that it has been upgraded. While upgrading, the existing syllabus has not been tampered at all. They have only enriched. And maybe you can look at chapter number 6, the module number 6, which is totally a new topic with the emerging technologies. So therefore, considering all the factors that is required for our members' present day scenario, your new syllabus 3.0, it is a next level. So therefore, this particular 6-day program will be only focusing on 3.0 syllabus, which encapsulate the 2.0 syllabus also. So therefore, maybe when we do a 40 page of coverage, there will be another 10 to 15 page of an additional coverage. So that is why when we were discussing with chairman and secretary whether we should restrict with 1 hour session or not, they were very keen that no, the session should be for at least 2 hours. So that is why every day we have a 2 hour. And very rightly, CAAD Prasanna Kumar ji has made that point that early morning at 8:30, if at all members can assemble that to 200 plus and that too without a CPE program, that is only possible. The magnetism is possible only because of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India's course and the attraction for this ESA 3.0. Good. Now coming to the syllabus today, I'll be taking you to this first module today. First module is a very important module, and all the 6 modules has equal footage. Tomorrow's session, Mr. Vittal Raj will take, and day after tomorrow's session, Dr. Paul Jaker. So every day you will get a new flavor, and each module will be covered in toto, and this material will also be circulated. Point number three, it will be exam focused. It will be exam focused. That is assessment test focused. So it will be assessment test focused. And wherever you have a query, so I'll try to take you through this with 1 to maximum 1 hour, 15 minutes or 1.5 hours time. And at the end, 5 to 10 minutes, we'll have a interaction. Maybe 3 or 4, you can raise your hands. And whatever queries you have, note it down, or reflections you want to give, you can note it down. And at the end of the session, those who have raised your hands, you can unmute yourself. So we will request your name. So please unmute and then share your thoughts and also your queries. So most important, have a notebook with you, have a pen with you, and whatever points we'll be discussing, kindly note it down. And this entire examination, this assessment test will be majority, okay, substantial part will be multiple choice. Maybe 1 or 2 case studies will be given. 1 or 2 case studies will be given. That also will be multiple choice only. So they'll give a case, a mini case, and based on that, multiple choice. So therefore, your entire testing mechanism is a multiple choice model only. Globally, this information systems examination pattern itself is multiple choice. So therefore, you have to fine-tune your understanding, your conceptual clarity in the subject in that direction. So therefore, I'll take you to slowly to each and every topic. So I'll give us first a brief summary of what module one is all about. Brief summary of what module one is all about. Module one is about the fundamentals of IS audit. And here concepts will be understood and what are all the stages or phases in IS audit and what are the qualities required. Okay. Generally, when we look at, I'll be taking you to all the multiple questions here. And when we go through these questions, the objective of doing this is not to get the answer. No. We will only focus on why the other three wrong answers are not the right answers. I repeat once again, the objective is if we do 10 questions, you have 4 answers. That means it is not 10 answers we have completed. No, we have understood 40 concepts, 10 into 4, 40. So please be attentive, have a paper, have a pen, pencil or whatever it is, note down the points and that only will give you the strength. So this is a very serious session. Remember, this being a non-CPE, when we have the attention of all the members, meaning all of us are very serious participants. So till the session is over and I'll be requesting the members to share your queries or your reflections, kindly keep it in mute. Kindly keep it in mute and share your thoughts at the end. Good. Now, let me now take you to so first concepts, process. Then when you do the IS audit, there is a very nicely Mr. Prasanna Kumar has put it that I am not technologically conversant, but I know how to get the work from or how to get the information from the right people. So that is the best quality of a true leader. So getting things done from the right people. So he has understood that, okay, we will get it from the right, the experts. Similarly, in an IS audit process, in an IS audit, to actually implement your audit. So because it is a technology-based information stored there, you need to use tools to take the data out, analyze the data out, and take the summary of the information. So you need tools. So especially we will not, this entire, this ISA 3.0 is not on testing your programming skills. It is not testing your CAT tool operational skills. So operational skills will not be tested. Your programming skills will not be tested. But then what will be tested? Your conceptual clarity. your conceptual clarity only will be tested. And all of you are chartered accountants. This is a post-qualification course. You are good in accounting. You are good in audit. So the next stage is when the information is in a machine, how you need to do an audit. So that additional skills and clarity is what is required. So that is how your entire syllabus is actually framed. Maybe you want to be a security expert. You want to be a, we have a specialized course for it. So this ISA 3.0 is not a course testing your programming skills, testing your, operational skills, nothing like that. But you must know what the tool is. So maybe you have a team of youngsters also. We have a mix of senior professionals and young professionals. So today, that mix is very, very important. Whether it is senior or junior, that experience plus the technology understanding. And over a period of time, chartered accountants will be well-versed. Maybe 1 week or 2 days or 3 days when you work in a CAT tool, operational level understanding, you will automatically get. So that is not an issue at all. Now, let me now take you to all the six steps quickly. We have a very, very challenging time ahead. So therefore, I will be very, very time conscious. So you have to cooperate with me with respect to the time. So let me now take you to the topic. This topic will be very interesting and I will go one by one. IT-enabled assurance services. IT-enabled. Today, assurance is part of, and this entire, this internal audit, our Dr. Paul Jaikar is part of the Institute of Internal Auditors also. He is in the executive committee. And the skills, the IT skills is very, very significant with respect to internal audit. And in internal audit only, you give the assurance to the management. You give the assurance to management that things are proper. So therefore, IT-enabled assurance services, let us go one by one. Okay, good. Now, which of the following factors should not be considered in establishing the priority of audits included in an annual audit plan? Okay, priority of audits included in an annual audit plan. Let me read the options. Okay, and try to understand one by one. Now, what is this question? Which of the factors should not be considered? Okay, that means the other three are to be considered in establishing the priority of audits included in an audit annual audit plan. Now, I mentioned this point very clearly. You are a chartered accountant. You are into audit. So therefore, your fundamental audit quality inside you is sufficient to answer this question. And especially this is about an audit plan. So that means three are considered to be priority in annual audit plan. So what are they? Let me take prior audit finding. So we generally, when we go to a bank audit, we say, bring the RBI audit report, bring the concurrent audit report. Why? Based on that, you will actually plan your should I have to be here for 3 days or 2 days or 1 day late, shall we close it? So therefore, A is an answer to be considered. A is should be considered. So A is not the answer. Okay. The time period since the last audit. Now, what do you mean by this? When was the last audit done? What is the time now? Is it 1 month, 2 month, 3 month, 6 month, 1 year? Generally, RBI audit would have been done. Okay. That scope is different. So therefore, time period since the last audit, scope of the last audit, that also can be included. Okay. So B is also not the criteria because if the lesser the time, more the time. So should be considered. The time period also should be considered. RDT's procedural changes. Now, what do you mean by RDT? Auditor, you are going to do RDT, the client. Their procedural changes, when they change their, you have done the audit for the past 3 or 4 years. So last year, what was the procedure? This year, what is the? They'll say, sir, we have changed a lot of things. People have gone from this place to that place. Procedure we have changed. System we have changed. the format we have changed. Oh, then my audit procedures will change. So therefore, that is also a reason should be considered. Use of audit software. During the audit only, you will use the audit software. So therefore, this audit software, which I will use, only when after you plan the audit only, you will go for this. So should not be considered. So I repeat, 51D is should not be considered. Okay, good. Now this is over. So I may be a little slow in the first few questions. I want you to actually come to the group with respect to reading the question. Most important, I'll tell you, you have to read the question properly. I repeat, read the question properly. Okay, right. Which of the following is least likely to be included in review of assess to in a review to assess the risk of fraud in application system? Least likely to be included in review to assess the risk of fraud in an application system. Now, what is least likely? So I will not consider that. That means other three are, you have to consider, you have to include to review the assess the risk of fraud in an application. What do you mean by an application system? A software which is used for your business. Example, an accounting software, an ERP software, a cloud-based accounting software. This is called an application system. Now, least likely to be included in review of to assess the risk of fraud. So in that application system, risk is there. Maybe controls are not there and anybody can log in and they can delete the entry, they can change the entry, then risk of fraud is there. Okay, so I'm just giving some examples. Now, what is least likely to be included in review? That means that particular answer has nothing to do with the risk of fraud. Volume of transaction, yes. More the volume, probability of risk is more. So that has to be considered. It is most likely to be considered to assess the risk of fraud. So A is not the answer. Likelihood of error. Now, what is this likelihood of error? Likelihood of error, least likely included in a review to assess the risk of fraud. Likelihood of error is actually a risk assessment. I repeat the word. What is the likelihood of error? This word will come actually in risk assessment. And tomorrow, Mr. Vittal Raj will be taking you to GRC. What is GRC? Is called governance, risk assessment and compliance. So there you will understand this concept. Which of the following is least likely to be included in review to assess the risk of fraud in application system? This likelihood of error is least likely to be included in a review to assess the risk of fraud. I'll explain this. Please wait for some time. I'll go to C&D and I again come back. Value of transaction, volume of transaction also you have to consider, and value of transaction also you have to consider to assess the risk of fraud. Both you have to consider. So least likely will not. Least likely, you will not consider. Least likely to be included, you will not include that at all. Volume you have to include. Value you have to include for risk of fraud, because 100 rupees or 1 lakh rupees or 10 lakh rupees. Extent of existing control. So your existing control, whether it is taking care of probability of a fraud. Probability of a fraud. So that is to be considered. So what is your existing control will be there, but it will not be implemented. Control will not be there at all. Control, it was there sometime back and after that people left it. So that means that is most likely to be included to review. You have to review the existing control. You have to review the value of transaction. You have to review the volume of transaction and review the likelihood of error to assess the risk of fraud. Now, to assess the risk of fraud, likelihood of error is the most likely, because you need to know that what is the problem. If likelihood of error is not there, then there is no possibility of it. So therefore, likelihood of error is least likely or most likely. You have to first understand. Like for example, I'll give you an explanation for this particular point. What is called likelihood of error? The error will be very less. What is called likelihood means probability. 2%, 3%. Which of the following is least likely to be included in a review of to assess the risk of fraud? Now I'm asking a question. Sir, is it possible to go inside the entry and change the entry. Entry is already there for 55,75,000. 55,75,000, is it possible to edit? I am asking this question. They say, sir, controls is there, that is there. The likelihood of error. Okay. Now, actually, the word error means it is done intentionally or unintentionally. If it is done intentionally, then it is called as a risk of fraud. Likelihood of error is least likely, because when the moment it is intentional error, we don't use a word called error. It is called as a fraud. So fraud and error don't go together. Don't go together. Error is unintentional. Okay. And likelihood of error has nothing to do with the fraud. You need to have some other thing. So please understand that line. So fraud means intentional. Volume, value, controls will have a link. Error is unintentional. So that will not come under fraud. So likelihood of error is least likely. So please understand the meaning of all this. Then it will be very clear. An IS auditor discovers evidence of fraud. An IS auditor discovers evidence of fraud perpetrated with the manager's user ID. Perpetrated the manager's user ID. Oh my God. The manager has written the password inside. And remember, guys, whatever I'm discussing, this is not an entertainment session. So kindly don't sit idle. Use a notebook and pen, and whatever points I'm discussing, note down the question, answers, why the others are also not an answers also. Anyhow, this will be circulated, but the answers will not be circulated. So therefore, please note down the answers and the reasons also. An IS auditor discovers evidence of fraud. Okay, he already discovered. Perpetrators of the manager's user ID. Oh, manager's user ID, somebody has used it. Presuming manager has not used it. The manager has written the password inside his or her desk drive. You open the desk drive, it is written there. The IS auditor should conclude that. Now, what he will conclude? So in the drawer itself, it is there. Drawer is not locked. Okay. Now here, manager's assistants perpetrated the fraud. Can you conclude like that? Wrong. Somebody else would have also done it. So A is wrong. Perpetrator cannot be established beyond doubt. This is the absolute. I will say the manager is, you can give any name to it. You can say FOOL, you can say IDIOT. Okay, any word you can give. Generally, there is a very interesting protection of information assets will be there. Dr. Paul Jaikar only, I have requested him to take amazing session. There, how password? There is an international meaning for that. There is an attribute for it. Passwords are like your innerwear. Passwords like your innerwear. Nobody else can use it. Nobody else should know about it also. What is the size? What is the thing? You only will know about your innerwear. So to that extent, the password should be. Now, perpetrator cannot be established beyond doubt. When he is written it in his drawer, anybody could have done it. It can be an external thief, internal person, anybody. So B is the right answer. Okay. But anyhow, we'll see why C in D is wrong answer. Fraud must have been perpetrated by a manager. Manager, manager's assistant. How can you say? No, you only came in. That is why you did it. Like that, then CCTV camera, all this other stuff is there. But this is not the way IS auditor can conclude. And first of all, he should not have written it. That itself is wrong. So therefore, perpetrator cannot be established. So you have to say, who did it? It is not possible because it is very difficult to establish. System admin to perpetrator, system administrator, manager, manager assistant. Difficult. It is difficult. He himself has written it openly. Okay. So 53B. Now please come to the 54. Okay. We don't have much time. Let me go quickly. Which of the following situations would increase the likelihood of fraud? Okay. So let us say, which of the following should increase the likelihood of fraud? Wow. Okay. So increase. Now that means other three will decrease the likelihood of fraud. Please interpret the question like this. Okay. Which of the following would decrease the likelihood of fraud? Three will decrease the likelihood of fraud. Only one will increase. Okay. For example, this is a very, 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 I will say, a significant question. Okay. Database administrator are implementing the data structure. This is called data structure. Okay. So what is called as data structure? So should it be a linear data structure, non-linear, static array? Should it be queued, stacked, dynamic means? So database administrator are implementing the data structure. So database implementing, administrators are implementing the data structure would increase the likelihood of fraud. Actually, database administrator only should implement data structure. Okay. So, because they are the guy who designed it. So, who is an administrator? So, he is a guy who will design the data, who will actually structure the database. Okay. So, how many records one table can hold, how many fields it will be there, and what is the multiple table, how you are going to connect. Okay. So, that is called as data structures. Okay. So, data structure is how the multiple tables will be connected. It will be a flat one, or a tree one after another, or a networked model. So he's the guy who will actually structure it. So therefore, which of the following would increase? So that will not, that is actually his responsibility. So D is not the answer. Operational support staff are implementing changes to batch schedules. Now, what is called batch schedules? So there will be a bunch of, generally it is batch processing means you will have the input records like checks, invoices will be, and that will be bundled as 50-50-50 at called batches, and based on that only data will be entered. So the operational support staff can be an accountant or the functional department staff. So they are changing the batch schedules. They are changing the batch schedule. Now we are changing the batch schedules. There can be reasons because they are the users. So when they are the users, they are the guys who will be actually responsible for that. So likelihood of fraud, changing the batch schedule, actually, for example, no, don't do batch 2 today, batch 2 do tomorrow. So, but you will have batch control in it. What is called batch control? How many invoices are there? What is the total of the invoices? That is called hash total, financial total. Come control is there. Schedule change, will it increase the fraud? No, you have to go inside the document and do some change. Then only fraud will happen. So scheduling will not do any, it will not increase the likelihood of fraud. Okay, it may delay the process. That's it. So C is not the answer. So C and D is not the answer. A and B is the answer. Oh, now application programmer. Application programmer implementing changes to test program. Application programmer implementing changes to production. What is test program? Test means test data, what is the output? Is it going to have any fraud? No. But production program, live data, that is fraud. So A is the answer, matter over. Once you understand patar, until you understand problem will be there. Neural network are effective in detecting fraud. Okay. Actually, neural network, we will discuss a lot about it in chapter number 6. I'll be again back for chapter 6. That is called artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence. Remember, guys, human brain is much, 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 much superior to the processor of the computer. Only thing is, only problem with humans is we don't use our brain. Okay. We only use not 7% or 9% or 10% only we use our brain power. And the greatest scientist of the century, Isaac Newton. Okay, Newton has used up to 13% of his brain power. We have not used that, but at least maybe I would have used only 5 or 6%. So neural networks are effective in detecting fraud. Now, what is neural network? It is that it is one avatar. If Mahavishnu is a very big power, and avatars of Mahavishnus are there. Okay, 10 avatars are there, dasavatarams are there. Like the neural network is one avatar of artificial intelligence, one avatar. Okay. Now that avatar will do a lot of games will be there. So what is this neural network? Are effective in detecting fraud? So you need to understand neural network. That is why please look at this particular slide. I have just given you detecting credit card frauds using artificial neural networks. Oh, so how is it? It is similar to biological neuron, which accepts many inputs, processes it, and gives us a single output. See, today, you don many roles. If you are a woman, you are a daughter to your father and mother. You are a mother to your daughter or son. So you are a spouse to your husband. Okay, you may be a friend to your classmates or college mates. You don multiple roles. Now, the way you will speak to your father, you will not speak to your son. The way you will speak to your friends, you will not speak to your husband. Okay, of course, husband language will be different. The way you will speak to a friend will be different. Okay, so I need not tell. All of us have experienced that also. So an artificial neural network is similar to a biological neuron, which accepts many inputs and gives us a single output. Okay, so here, neural networks are effective in detecting frauds because they can discover new trends because they are inherently linear. Discover new trends and all they will not discover. Okay, solve problems where large and general sets of training data are not obtainable. Will they solve problem? Okay, please read the previous slide, you will understand. Attack a problem that requires consideration of a large number of input variables. Now, credit card fraud, what it will do? PIN will be, people will try 4 or 5 times PIN, tack, 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 tack. Now the system that side, when the moment you have crossed 3 times, server should immediately, dimaka bati pang bulb should glow and some perpetrator is there, we should stop the network. So neural network are effective in detecting fraud and then it will sever the connection. So your password try is over, that's all. So that is one. Attack problems. It will not solve problem. It will not discover new trend. That is the purpose of discovering new trend. So that is a neural network. Okay. So C, 55C. Why D is not the answer? Make assumption. Assumption and all it will not do. Okay. Good. So now 56. The first step in managing risk of a cyber attack. What you should do? Cyber attack. Virus has come inside the system. Okay. Now, telecommunication, there is a DOS attack. DOS means denial of service attack. Okay. So all this stuff is happening. So there are various cyber attacks, or it can even be social engineering will not come under cyber attack. Okay. Maybe you can say a type of cyber attack, social engineering. Now, what is the first step you have to do in managing the risk of a cyber attack? Okay. Assess the vulnerability impact. Okay. Vulnerability impact you will do before an attack. Okay. What are the vulnerable areas? Okay. And what will happen if attack happens? So that is before. So A is not the answer. Evaluate the likelihood of threat. So that is also you will do before the first step in managing risk of a cyber attack. Okay. So attack has happened. So A and B is not the answer. Okay. Those are all before. Now after. Identify critical information system. Now, this is very important. Now, it is very common in our human tendency itself. Now, there is a phone call is coming that you are actually in a holiday and a phone call is coming from your neighbor. He's called, where are you? What happened? Because police and all has come. Your home is actually burglared. A thief has come and your house has been broken. Immediately, so there is an attack. Immediately, what your mind will think? What are the critical assets in your home? Oh, my jewels. Oh, this costly cash I have kept it. What would have happened? You will not worry about gas cylinder. You will not worry about the fridge, whether it is switched on or switched off, because those are not critical. What is critical? Immediately, that only you will think. The first step in managing risk. What would have happened? I think I should have kept it in a locker. Okay, so identify the critical information, whether it has lost or not. That is the next thing. So 56C. Next. Now, what is 57? 50. Which of the following refers to imaging of original media in presence of an independent third party? This is done using forensic auditor. So I am appointed as forensic auditor. Okay. So, then I will go to, they will say, sir, up to 13th, after today's date is 14th. So yesterday is 13th. Sir, up to 13-6-2021. Okay. So past 2 year data up to 13-6-2021, you have to analyze the data. You have to do the forensic audit with respect to the 4 ledger accounts, which I'm going to give. What and all the transaction happened through bank, cash, journal, gain and loto, losco, everything. So now, imaging of original media. So what is called imaging? It is called, in a common term, it is called as ghost copy. So I will take an empty hard disk connect that empty hard disk to that all the computers, and then take an image. Image means ghost copy. So sector to sector, track to track, the data will be copied in presence of an independent third party, because they should not say, no, you have tampered the data. That data is not my data. This data is my data. Later they should not say. So is it for identifying? Is it for preserving? Is it for analyzing? So which of the following refers to imaging? That means copying the original data, what it means. Okay. A forensic image is a special type of copy of the original evidence. It contains all of the data found in the original, but that data is encapsulated in a forensic file format, which makes it the tamper proof. So this is the example what I gave. And what is the purpose of this? Which of the following refers to image? Why you take the data? Okay. Is it to identify the transaction? No. Already transaction is why you take a copy. You want to preserve. You clone that. You clone it so that it will be an evidence in future. That cannot be an evidence. People can tamper it, but this evidence cannot be tampered. That is why you take a copy. Okay. Which of the following refers to imaging or original? So preserving, or of course for analyzing you do it, but which of the following refers to imaging the original media? It is to preserve the originality of the data. Okay. Not to identify. Of course, identify, that only you are imaging. Okay. These words are very, very important words. Okay. Please read this. You will understand why the data imaging is done. So it's a special type of copy that contains all data found, but the data is encapsulated. That means encrypted or put it in one particular place, which makes it tamper proof. Tamper proof. Okay. That is a preserve. Okay. But what is a measure of IT general controls? So what is a measure of IT general control? As a measure of the general IT general controls, an organization decides to separate those who can input data from those that can reconcile or approve data. Very interesting. Is it a good move? Why? Okay. See how the questions are. Okay. As a measure of IT general controls, an organization, what is called general controls? Okay. General controls means, for example, you want to have authentication, your user ID and the password. Original, you have to log in first. So that is the general control. Everybody can't go inside. Okay. So that is called the IT general control. So, and it can even be a biometric, okay, or it can be even logging in the register before you enter a particular place, keeping a CCTV camera, okay. All these are general controls. An organization decides to separate those who are input data and those who can reconcile approved data. This is actually in every auditing book, it will be there. Why auditing book? Maker, checker. Is it a good move? Yes. Wow. So that means the moment, is it a good move? Yes means answer is definitely ARC. Is it a good move? No means answer is BRD. So answer is ARC. B and D is not answer. You need not read that. So answer, why? Why is the next? So that means you have to go. Yes, it is a good move. It can help prevent unauthorized data entry. Okay. Seems to be correct. It is a good move. Inputting data, reconciling data requires different skills. No. It is input data also, you need to understand data. Otherwise, they will only be typing. So you cannot keep a 10th standard or 12th standard boy to enter accounting data, which is a very, very sensitive accounting data center. So you need skills also for input. You need to understand data and you cannot type it wrongly in some places. And reconciling data requires different skills. So that is not the purpose. Maybe skills are there, but is that the main purpose? No, the main purpose is the unauthorized data entry should not happen. If it happens, the checker will actually identify. That is the purpose of 58A. Okay. So 58C seems to be, but that is not the main purpose. Okay. Seems to. So 59. A holistic approach to deterrence and prevention of fraud. Deterrence means avoidance. Okay. Deterrence. And the prevention of fraud. Of course, both are very, so to deter means you don't go there. Okay. So you say, இந்த தமிழ்ல தேர் இஸ் அ வெரி நைஸ் சாங், வேப்ப மரத்து நின்னு பேயுன்னு ஆடுதுன்னு விளையாட போகும்போது சொல்லி வைப்பாங்க, உன்னுடைய வீரத்தை குழிந்திலேயே கிள்ளி வைப்பாங்க. மீனிங் த பீப்புள் வில் சே நோ நோ டோன்ட் பிளே நியர் த நீம் ட்ரீ, தேர் வில் பி அ கோஸ்ட் தேர், சோ யுவர் இந்த சைல்டுஹுட் இட்செல் தே வில் ஆக்சுவலி create the fear in you that ghost is there, ghost is there. That is called deterrence. So don't go near a neem tree. Actually, the scientific reasons are different. So a holistic approach to deterrence and prevention of fraud. Okay. So what is the complete approach? So you have to prevent fraud, which is the best one. Okay. So now it is like your definition, you have to find the meaning of it. So 15, it is like match the following. So other is not prevention of fraud. Okay. So let us go. Compensating employees adequately to minimize temptation. Will it actually prevent fraud? No, employees, always you cannot satisfy. Please understand. You give a 10,000 rupees salary. No, you increase it to 3 times. You increase it to, they will say, oh, if he's increasing 3 times, then they are getting more profit. They should have given me 4 times then. So for the need of the human being, you can satisfy. By greed of the human being, you can never satisfy. So compensating employee adequately, adequately from your side, it will be adequate. Employee said always inadequate only. Okay, good. So they will always compare to the next bigger salary. They will never be happy. Okay. So very rare qualities nowadays. Those days and all it was there because people were contented. Today people are not contented. Okay. Very few exceptions are there. Establishing severe. So B is not the answer. Sorry, D is not the answer. Establishing severe punishment for fraud. So today there is a very beautiful one film they said. So a villain will say, today there are only 2 kinds of people. One, people who have actually he was caught. The other kind of people, they were not caught. They are caught and not caught. They are the only 2 categories of people, a villain will say. So it is not good people and bad people, caught and not caught. So the severe punishment, will it deter or prevent the fraud is maybe you can consider, but not fully. Okay. Focusing on integrity of new recruits. Okay. Only new recruits you are worried about it. What about the existing? Okay. So B, C, you can consider. Okay. Consider. Strengthening our governance and management framework. Very, very important. Very, very important. They say, what do you mean by success? Success means growth should be there. Progress should be there. And then only success. So growth means turnover increases growth. And along with that, you add ethics. That is called progress. And along with that ethics, ethics means what? Honesty. Along with that, you should add what is called a spirituality, humanity. Then only it is called success. So all this, how you can bring it? So growth alone is not sufficient. You have to bring ethics. You have to bring culture. You have to bring the governance. You have to bring the framework. That only can actually strengthen, that only can deter fraud. Okay. So it is 59A. After initial investigation, IS auditor has reason to believe, very interesting word, guys. Okay. That there is possibility of fraud. The IS auditor has to expand activities to determine whether an investigation is warranted, report the matter to the audit committee. Okay. If he believes that, what will you do? Okay, will he report the matter to audit committee? If he has to report the matter to the audit committee, he should have evidence. So B is not the answer. Has reason to believe. Reason to believe means he should have evidence actually. But will he report directly to audit committee? Is it a question? That is a question. So please wait. So B, will wait for some time. Report the possibility of fraud to top manager and ask how they will like to proceed. This is also, we'll wait. Reporting to audit committee, reporting to top management. Consult with the external legal counsel to determine the course of action to be taken. You are the auditor, you are IS auditor, has reason to believe that there is possibility of fraud. Possibility of fraud. So you have not, you believe that because of certain transactions, possibility of fraud is there. Okay, you only opine. Okay, you only opine. Come to first one. Expand activities to determine. Opinion after that determination, whether investigation is warranted. This is very important. That means you have evidence. You have to collect evidence. So BCD will come later. But first, you need to determine. The word determine is very important. What is called reason to believe? You opine. There is opinion. Your opinion can be wrong also. I'm telling you. The opinion can be wrong also. It's So that is my expand your activity, do substantial testing to determine, okay, confirm whether an investigation is warranted. Then a forensic audit, let them do it. Let the management take a call. You are only IS auditor. Okay. So 60A. Okay, good. Now I'll take you to the first one, IS audit. Okay. IS audit. Good. Now look at IS audit. Quick, guys. Let us go quickly. Concepts of IS audit. Good. Primary purpose. Least likely, most likely, primary. Okay. You have to be very careful. Why very careful? This primary purpose, whenever the word primary is there, all four are answer. Only one is the priority, primary. See, in your, all of us, we are in a family system. Okay. Maybe nucleus family or a joint family. Now, in your family, many close family members are there. Father, mother, spouse, children, sister, in-laws, okay, and son-in-law, daughter-in-law. Now, you list all the family members and try to say who's the most important, primary most important, without whom it is not possible to live. It is not possible to live. So, you will actually say you can eliminate every person from your life. So slowly you can eliminate, you will feel that difficulty. Your heart will actually internally bleed, but you will actually cry when you are going to cut off one particular name. That is your very close family member, very, very close family member. And they are none other than your spouse. They are none other than your spouse, because spouse, whether it is from women's side or men's side, because primary person in a family. Okay, so all are important. So that is why the word primary purpose means all four are answer. But one is the most important answer. The primary purpose and existence of an audit charter. What is audit charter, guys? Defines the purpose and gives authority to conduct audit and defines responsibility. This is very important. This is primary purpose. This is primary purpose. What is it? What is the authority that gives authority to conduct audit? So that means some law will say, sometimes management will say, there is internal audit. Internal audit law will not say. Management will say, energy audit. Why you do energy audit? Okay. So you do energy audit only to save energy, because it is a management audit. Gives authority to conduct audit legally or through management and defines area of responsibility. So primary purpose and existence of an audit charter. Document the audit process? No. Formally document the audit department's plan of action? No. Document a code of conduct, professional conduct? No. Describe the authority and responsibility of the audit department? Yes. Got authority and responsibility. Now, next one. That is audit chart. Which of the following control classifications identify the cause of a problem and minimize the impact of threat? Oh, very important question. Following control. Generally, remember this entire 6 days, we are only going to see what is called as PDC. PDC. PDC means preventive control, detective control, corrective control. Okay. Now, we'll be discussing a lot about this, but which of the following control identify the cause of the problem? Cause. Now, please look at this. Which will identify the cause of the problem and minimize the impact of threat? So, corrective control will limit to the extent of any damage. Detective control identifies the incident. So, identify the problem and minimize the impact. That is very important. And minimize the impact. So, therefore, if the question is, okay, if the question is only identify the cause of problem, means it is called detective control. But question is not that. And minimize the impact of threat. That is called corrective control. Limit to the extent of damage is corrective control. So answer is D. So please be very careful. Question, sometimes identify, minimize. Only identify means detective. Identify and minimize, then only corrective. So minimize the impact of the threat is called corrective control. Okay. Preventive is you don't identify. You actually stop. You prevent the occurrence of the event. Okay. So occurrence of the event, you stop it. You prevent it. Okay. So that is D. To conduct a system audit, IS auditor should be qualified, should be experienced. What it should be? You should be technically brilliant, which is correct. Okay. These are the five characters of an IAS auditor. Okay, five characters. All this is taken from, it is not taken from clouds. Remember, all these are taken from your institute study material. Okay, now please look at this. This is your, okay, this is your, look at this. So this is your link for your background material. Okay, and so you can go there and you can find out the background material there. Okay, so I'll just put all those stuff here. So it is already there. You can download the background material. So this is where your background material is. And all these are only taken snapshots from all your background material. Okay. It is there. My sincere suggestion to all of you, read the study material. No. They are only asking multiple choice question. I will read multiple choice question from Ipini, Tapini, Tapini, Tapini and all. No. Nothing will happen. You have to read, understand, be clear with the concept. Study material means what? Our institute alma mater has done that work. A lot of people are involved in it, and including Dr. Paul Jaikar has also been a contributory to, and Mr. Vittal Raj has also been a contributory to the study material. So all the learned people have actually spent their time, effort, energy, their experience in developing this. So I am only taking some of the snippets from there and I'm sharing with you. So read the material. Okay. To conduct a system audit, an IAS auditor should be have the experience, ability to make independent decision. So all these are general qualities. He should be dependable, communication skills, understand business. Okay. Now please answer this question, which will be ideal. Okay. Should be technically at par with client's technical, sir. That is not required. He may be technically brilliant. I need not be technical. So A is not answer. Be able to understand the system that is being on. Very important. Very, 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 very important. You need to understand. You need not be technically conversant. No, I will do. No, Prasanna Kumarji said, Java, Giva, I don't know. Yeah, I also don't know Java, Giva. But you must understand how Java will work. You must know why Java is used. What is called JRE, Java Runtime Environment. And a version number 1.0, 2.0, what is the difference? Okay, you must know. You must understand what it will do. You need not be a technically skilled person to know the internal architecture. Okay, so I need not know how the coronavirus will be cured. I must know corona, how it will come, how I have to protect myself from not being affected by corona. Matter over. Okay, so that is it. Possess knowledge in the area of current technology. That is okay. If you have, okay. If you don't know, also okay. This is not technology you need to know. Okay, you must only know the business. You must know how, you must understand how technology is used in business. That's all. Beyond that, you are a chartered accountant. You are an IAS auditor. Okay. Only possess knowledge of auditing. That is also well not sufficient. Govinda. That's all. You must understand how technology is. So today, technology is inseparable. Technology and accounting, can you separate it? It is not possible. Technology auditing, you can separate. It is not possible. Technology and income tax, you can separate. Not possible. Okay. Technology GST, not possible. It is all inseparable. So therefore, I will only know GST. I will not understand. I don't want to know technology. Difficult. I will only understand income tax provision. I don't want to go into technology. Difficult today. That is why these subjects have taken importance. So B is the answer. Be able to understand. So 3B. Good. Next. Which of the following are most common? That means all the other three are also common. Most commonly used to mitigate risk. Discovered by organization. Okay, most commonly used. Now look at most commonly used to mitigate. Mitigate means reduce, control, bring it under your control. Tumare muthime. Okay, you have to bring it under control. Which are the most commonly used? Personal, people, resources. Resources means machine, men, material. These are called, they say 5M, money. Okay, this is most commonly used. Resources are also used. Personal is also used. Threat is actually not an answer at all. So if threat is there, risk is there. Okay. Vulnerability will be there. Then vulnerability, if it is confirmed, it become threat. Threat will become risk. That is how the circle is. Okay. Okay. So control includes setting standards. So the controls. Okay. Very important. Okay. Today, which is the most commonly used to mitigate risk? Controls. Information system audit and control, written by John Weber. Okay, so your control If only when control is there, audit will come. If control is not there, where is audit? What you will audit? Okay, so that is why. So A is the answer, 4A. The rate of change in technology increases the importance of. The rate of change in technology increases the importance of outsourcing the IS function. Okay. Implementing and enforcing good process. What is this? The rate of change in technology increases the importance of technology goes up. Okay. 10 years before, what the technology? What is the technology today? This is a very general question. Okay. But you have to understand it properly. Will you outsource the IS function? Is it correct? No. You may outsource for a certain reason, but just because technology has changed, will you outsource this? A is not the answer. Okay, so B, C, D is the answer. Meeting user requirement. Rate of change in technology increases the importance of meeting user requirement. So that is not user requirement means that can be internal functional department, your customer user requirement. So as it increases the importance of user requirement will always be there. Okay, that is always the priority, but as it increases the importance, never. Because that is a business need. That is not your technology related connect is there. That is always business need and that is always a priority. User requirement is always a priority. Okay, that is, you cannot connect with the technology. It will always be first. Okay, so A and D is not close to your answer. It should be B or C. Hiring personnel willing to make a career within the organization. So this has nothing to do with technology at all. Okay. So naturally, answer should be by elimination, it should be B. Let us read B. Implementing and enforcing good process. So rate of technology increases, the importance of, yes, as technology increases, your old controls, you have to change it to new control. Implement a good process. Enforce good process. Because that old controls may be ineffective, may not be useful, may be an addition, that will be a burden. Once upon a time, it was a control, now it is a burden. So therefore, the importance of implementing and enforcing good processes is the ideal answer. Okay. What means the rate at which opinion of the IS auditor would change if he selects a larger sample size? What means the rate at which opinion of IS auditor would change if he selects a larger sample size? This is a answer you have in audit sampling itself. Okay. In standards of audit sampling itself, you have an answer for this question. This question is taken straight away from standards on auditing. Okay. So, IS at what means the rate at which? What means the rate? The rate at which opinion of IS auditor will change if he selects a larger sample size. Smaller sample size, larger sample size. Smaller sample size, my opinion will be different. Larger sample size, my opinion will be different. So what is that? What means the rate at which the opinion of the IS auditor will change? Okay. Smaller audit size means, is it something related to materiality, risk-based audit, controls? Okay. Controls, will it, the rate at which the opinion of IS auditor would change if he selects a larger sample size? Now, the word itself says rate. Rate means percentage. Controls cannot be percentage. Okay. And risk-based audit is a process. Risk-based audit is a process. So therefore, it is not rate. Materiality is actually subjective. It cannot be a rate. It is subjective. Okay. So you have to analyze the circumstances, situation, quantity, value, volume. Okay. So all these you have to consider. So materiality is not rate. Audit risk is percentage. So audit risk, if it is, for example, higher the audit risk, lower the audit sample. Lower the audit risk, higher the audit sample. Simple. Simple. Very, very simple. Now, where is your answer? And your answer is actually in your standards on audit. So I'll just share with you. Sorry. So this is your... essay on audit sampling. Look at this. This is your essay on audit. So, essay 530. This is your essay 530. Audit sampling. You have answer here. So, please read that. which of the following cannot be classified as an audit risk? Okay, cannot be classified as an audit risk. Actually, your audit risk is the product of inherent risk, detection risk, and okay, your audit risk is a product of inherent risk, detection risk, and control risk. That is called total risk, total audit risk, TAR, TAR. Okay, very interesting. These are all, many things are there, your audit risk formula. Okay, so many things I want to give. Actually, I think I have given it here. Audit risk, look at this. Audit risk is calculated as formula of IR, CR, DR. Okay, so therefore, it is administrative risk is your answer. That is your what you call uncommon friend here. Okay, 7D. And what is your, we'll discuss all this inherent control and detection risk slowly. And all this is there in the SA, this is your audit sampling, it is there. Okay, please go through. After you enter a purchase order in an online system, you get a message. Well, this is actually a very practical question. Okay, you enter into purchase order in an online system. Request could not be processed due to lack of funds in your budget. Chuchu. This is an example, what error? Okay. So now slowly we are going into the preventive detective corrective. Detective is, you have to, we already know what is detective means. Detective is actually identify the incident. So here it is not identity. There is no incident happened. It is only preventing the incident. So therefore, is it detective? No. Is it corrective? You purchase for 800 rupees, you purchase and you enter into your credit card or whatever your debit card number. It says due to lack of funds in your budget. What is it? It prevents. It is a preventive control. Okay, that is a preventive. Okay, it doesn't allow you to go ahead. So it is. So it is never corrective or detective. Recovery is just like that. They have added. Good. When developing a risk-based audit strategy. An IS auditor should conduct, a risk assessment to ensure that, okay, when developing a risk-based audit strategy, an IS auditor should conduct a risk assessment to ensure that controls need to mitigate risk are in place. Okay, this is a very, very interesting question. And tomorrow, our good friend, Mr. Vichal Raj, he will take you through this risk part of it. Okay, risk assessment, GRC, it's a very, very important topic. And many, they don't read this GRC. This is very, very, I will say, at the governance level. We just know SAW. So what is it? Your success is your progress along with your humanity, spirituality. That is your success. Okay. Your growth with the ethics is your progress. From progress, add your humanity and spirituality and other stuff. Then only it becomes success. So therefore, that ethics comes here. That is your honesty and your top management's governance. When developing a risk-based audit strategy, an IS auditor should conduct risk assessment to ensure what? Controls needed to mitigate risk are in place. Should conduct a risk assessment to ensure. Why he does a risk assessment? What is risk assessment means? Risk assessment means, first step, what are all the vulnerable areas? Okay, vulnerable areas, where and all the asset can be removed, clandestinely it can be removed, the money can be stolen, and revenue can be reduced, and cash can be defalcated. That is a vulnerability. So then vulnerability, then out of all these vulnerabilities, what are the threats? Threats are actually external. Okay, so then what is the risk part? So what is the likelihood that threat will actually crystallize? This is called risk assessment. So that is why this is a round I have given here. Okay. So IS auditor should conduct risk assessment. Why he should conduct risk assessment? Okay. He should conduct risk assessment because gap analysis appropriate. Chumma has given this. So answer is between A, B, C. Audit risk are considered. In risk assessment, audit risk is later only. So once you do the risk assessment, then you will know whether an inherent risk is there, whether the risk is actually controlled risk or whether detection risk, then only we'll go for audit risk logic is totally different. You have to go for inherent risk, controlled risk and detection risk. But here risk assessment is with respect to business. Okay. You have to strategize your audit plan. So what will be your days, size, people, resources, and then you have to go for your audit risk. So then only you will. So risk assessment only will tell you the next step. So audit risk is later. So C is not answer. Appa A and B is answer. Controls need to mitigate risk are in place. Actually, risk assessment, controls needed to mitigate risk are in place. This is not the role of IS auditor. This is the role of management. So once risk assessment is there, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 areas are there. Then what management has to do? They will mitigate risk by implementing control. Is it IS auditor should? No. Why IS auditor doing it? What are the vulnerabilities and threats? He will identify. Based on that, he will go for the audit risk. Then he will plan his audit, tools, strategy, people, resources, personnel, and small size, sample size, big sample size. All these and all will come. So 9B. Okay. Reviewing management's long-term strategic plans. Reviewing management's long-term strategic plans. Okay. What is your 5-year plan? 10-year plan? Now, whether IS auditor should know about this? Yes. What is your 10-year plan? What is your 1-year plan? How would it sync with that? Sometimes your plan will be to complete ESA 3.0. But you are not studying study material. You are studying some other thing. Will you go towards finishing ESA 3.0? ESA 3.0 means 3.0 study material you have to study. That is your short term. Long term is completing 3.0. Short term is studying the study material of the Institute of Chartered Accountants. That is your short term. Then only you are in sync with your long term. So reviewing management's long term strategic plan helps the IS auditor. Helps the IS auditor to gain an understanding of the organization goals and objective. General answer. Okay, general answer. It seems to be, because once I know what is 10, there seems to be an answer. So I can't say no to it. But let us see the BCD. Test the enterprise internal control. Now, what is it? Long-term plans and internal control testing has no link at all. So B is not answer. Assess the organization's reliance on information system. Oh, organization reliance on information system. So to what extent long-term plan it will say? So long-term plan and reliance on information system has no connector. Maybe some small connector can be there. Light connect. Okay, what is your long-term plan? Technology, how you are dependent. To that extent only, you can say. C is not complete answer. Comparing A and C, A is a complete answer. You have to gain understanding. This word understanding of the business is very important. Understanding of the system. Understanding the management. Understanding the risk before you start IS audit. Oh, IS audit, I'm appointed. Monthly fees is 1,40,000 rupees. I'm very happy. No, directly you will go and ask the trial balance and voucher. That is financial audit. IS audit, you have to do all this stuff. You have to understand their goals. You have to understand their business. You have to understand risk management. You have to understand what technology they have done. Technology and business, how the connecting is there. If 4 days power is not there, can they do business without power? You have to understand the vulnerability, sensitivity of all this stuff with business. Then only you have to jump into IS audit. Okay. So C is not the answer. Determine the number of audit resources needed. That when you will come. You will come only after deciding your audit risk, sample size, load to load scandal. Then only it will come. So the long-term strategic plan has nothing to do with D. So A is the answer. A is the answer. Good. Now I will go only maximum up to 10-15, not beyond that. After that, I wish to hear from our friends. So then I will go for the next one. Now, let me now take you to question number. I will take you to question number 11. IS audit in phases. Which of the following forms of evidence would be considered to be most reliable? Most reliable when assisting an IS auditor develop audit conclusion. Audit conclusion, what is the most reliable? Most reliable means other three is also reliable. That is the best thing. Now, ratio analysis developed by IS auditor, reliable. Trend data obtained from internet. Okay. Trend will give you some inputs. I will not say most reliable. Okay, reliable. Okay, reliable. Ratio analysis, reliable. But ratio analysis developed by IS auditor, reports applied by line management. Client is giving the data, on that you prepare ratio. Is it reliable? Okay. I will say okay. Trend data also, I will say okay. okay? Because it is supplied by line management. Assurance via CSA. What is CSA? CSA means self-control. Self-control. What is it? You hammer in the head of every employee. You have to create your own ring. See, today, what is called, wearing a mask? Why you are wearing a mask? Why wearing a mask you are doing? Wearing a mask is control self-assessment. You are exposed to virus. Since you are exposed to virus, risk is there. That risk you are controlling by wearing a mask. Somebody else is actually sneezing, loku doing, then that is control self-assessment. Similarly, in organization, what is your risk? That risk, how you will protect it? Have a ring. You yourself have to do that process. That is called self-control. 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 Okay. Read it as self-control, not control self-assessment. Therefore, is it most reliable that for audit conclusion, it is actually internal audit, internal control. Control self-assessment is an internal control aspect, not an IS audit aspect. A confirmation letter from a third party for the verification account is absolutely most reliable. Because nowhere line management is involved, third party. So 11A. Okay. During the review of ID control or the process of defining IT service level, an IS auditor was most likely interview. Who I will interview when reviewing the controls? Okay. Control is already there. Now I want to test whether control is working, whether it is effective. Most likely interview whom? System programmer. That to defining IT service. IT service. IT service means there is an application system. There is a cloud accounting software. Okay. What is the services it gives? To whom you will actually interview? Okay. Will you interview the programmer? No. You will not interview programmer. Will interview the legal staff and IT service. What is the connect? No, sir. Connect. Business unit manager. Yes. He's the guy who will say, for my branch, for my unit, for my factory, what is required? What the system is giving to me? What it should give? What it is giving? Then you will know the controls, how it is effective or not. So 12C. Okay. Which of the following procedures would an IS auditor not perform during pre-audit planning to gain an understanding of the overall environment under review? Not to perform. Means other three I will perform in pre-audit. Review prior audit reports. Yes, I will do. Now, two key organization activities. Go around to the factory. Go around to the department. Then get introduced to, he's Ramachandran, he's Krishnamurti, he's Gopalakrishnan. Oh, very good. He will do that. A, D, I will do. Pre-audit planning, I will do. Then answer is B and C, I will not perform. Which I will not perform? Interview key members of the management. Understand? I will do that. I'll go and meet the MD. I'll go and meet the board of directors. I'll go and meet the managers. I'll go and meet the taxation manager. I'll go and meet the finance manager. I'll go and meet the CEO, CFO, all the top management people I will meet. I have to know. So B is an answer with respect to pre-audit planning. I will perform. Naturally, C is the answer. Perform compliance test. Compliance test is a post-audit planning. A, B, D, pre-audit. C, post-audit. So answer is C. Okay. Good. Now, come to the next. 14. The first step IS auditor should take when preparing the annual IS audit plan. The first step IS auditor should take when preparing annual IS audit plan. Now, the word first step means all the other three are also steps. All the other three are. See, the problem with this multiple choice question is, don't go for answers. If you go for answer, all four are answers. Here, all four, not to perform is very good because only one is the answer. But if it is this word, primary, most reliable, primary, first step, these are all very, very, very sensitive because other are also steps. First step IS auditor should take when preparing the plan. Planning, first step. Oh, you have to. That is why doing practical IS audit will give you a lot of ideas. Reading will never give idea. So that is why discuss. So I used to discuss a lot with Mr. Vittal Raj, Mr. Paul Jaker. So especially, sir, IS audit, epidi saving, first step what you will do, second step what you will do. So every day, Mr. Paul Jaker deals with IS audit. He does a lot of control self-assessment. So when you interact with such experienced people, and you also implement such, and you try, especially when you implement ISO audit for an insurance company, when you do an ISO audit for a member of a stock exchange, okay, these are all mandatory. So you will then only you will know what is the steps you will adopt. Okay, meet the audit committee members to discuss the ISO audit plan for the upcoming year. This is the first step. This is a step. Please keep it. Ensure that the IS audit staff is competent in areas that are likely to appear. Correct. IS audit, your staff should be competent. Appini people, the now only you have taken somebody for articles. Will you actually put them in IS audit? So B is a step, but whether that is the first step. Okay, wait. Performing a risk. So A and B steps. First step, please wait. We have to prioritize it. Performing a risk ranking of the current and proposed application system to prioritize the IS audit to be done. First is risk ranking. You have to know in your IS audit, this is the first, the risk assessment is first. Then only meeting audit committee members, your staff, whether, because then only you will match. Oh, see, if everything is strong, paka, very good, your risk assessment says 99% assurance is there. Only 1% you have to do the audit. Then I will change my strategy. The assurance itself is only 80%. Assurance is only 60%. Assurance is only 20%. Then what to do? Whichever place you touch, you will get audit points. So therefore, C is the answer. Okay. Very interesting. Read. Understand practically. Oh, purpose of compliance test is to provide reasonable assurance. Yes, naturally. Purpose of compliance test. What is substantive test? What is compliance test? I need not explain to chartered accountants. You know that. So compliance test is to provide reasonable assurance only for controls. Substantive test is for transaction. Okay. So therefore, this is actually an audit question. It is not an IS audit question also. This is pure audit question. Okay. Please look at this. There is no IS is there. Technology is there. System is there. Nothing is there. This is pure audit question. Okay. It is a compliance means control. Controls are working as prescribed. Correct. 15A. You need not go to documentation. You need not go to data personal. And exposures are defined and quantified. Nothing. Controls means compliance. Okay. Then now I'll take you to IS audit tools. Okay. IS audit tools, let me take. What is one of the key tests which can be ideally carried out using computer assisted audit tools? What is one of the key tests which can be ideally carried out using CAT? Okay. Now look at this. Identification of exceptional transaction based upon set criteria. Projections on future trends for specific parameters. Now look at the word key test that can be identified, ideally carried out. That means all are tests carried out by CAT. Now what is CAT? CAT can be anything. Ordinary spreadsheet is a CAT. A database management tool is a CAT. Okay. Or it can be even an audit software can be a CAT. Okay. You have, it is called as GAS. GAS, generalized audit software. Through that also you can actually do a lot of analysis, data analysis you can do. So which is one of the key tests which can be ideally carried out using CAT. So you need to understand what a CAT, what it can be done. So carry out employees appraisal skills. Appraisal skills is HR work. So B is not answer. Carry out employee reference check. That is you don't need a CAT. You have to only call somebody, Chair, Mr. Gobalakrishnan, do you know Mr. Paul Jaikar? That's all. This is what is called as reference. So I don't use CAT. Projections on future trends for specific parameters. So projection, how will you do it? Past data, add some 10%, 20% and multiply with some formula. Do you need CAT for that? Of course, you don't need a computer as an audit tool. You don't need. You need some tool. You need computer assisted tool required for projections, but you don't need an audit tool. So B is also not a naturally A's answer. Okay. Naturally A's answer. Identify exceptional transaction. Okay. Based on set criteria. I want cash entry passed in the accounts more than 10,000 rupees. Wow. That is exceptional transaction. Criteria more than 10,000. Okay. 21A. Find out best process carried out using CAT. That means all are process only. Out of that, you need best. All are good process. good la you need best. Let us see. Carrying on employee reference, same question. I think they are ulta. Okay, this is your study material has given such a model also. Okay, reference check, not an answer. Projection, specific trend, that is also not an, you don't need audit tools for it. You need only computer tools. Carrying on employee appraisal also you don't need. Identify potential areas of fraud. How? For example, whether there has been a parameter setting modification. Okay, what do you call it as a change management? So change, what are the changes done in data, in your parameter settings, anything. Those are all potential areas of fraud. For that you need tools. So 22A, manually you need not do it. You can actually give instructions to search the change management and that will be shown on the screen. What can be ideally carried out using CAT? Carried employee reference, no. Future trends, no. Employee appraisals, no. Identify data with inconsistent or erroneous. That you have to carry. So 23 is also A, which is one of the key tests which can be ideally carried out using CAT. Oh, so whether employee reference, no. Future trends, no. Carry employee appraisals, no. Naturally, it is A. So what is A? Perform various types of statistical analysis. Now here, all answers are A, but an examination need not be A. It can be others also. So please be careful. So you need to understand the connect between audit tool and perform various types of statistical analysis on the audit data. You will get the mean, median, mode, range, correlation, regression. If regression coefficient on sales on advertisement, last year data with current year data, regression. So these are all computer assisted audit tools will do. Okay, good. What is one of the key tests which can be ideally carried out using CAT? Key test. Okay. Competitor activity key. Competitor activity, estimation of competitor. Should you need CAT for that? Audit tool is only for your entity, not for competitors. Projection also you don't need. Employee appraisal you don't need. Establishing whether the controls are working. As specific. Working means you have to do the testing. So put the data and find out whether it prohibits or it detects. That is called control. So 25A. Okay. Then I'll take you to application control review. Okay. Now look at this. What is application control? In the accounting software, you will put a control. For example, cash voucher, cash entry, cash payment. In excess of 10, up to 10,000, you punch it, it will agree. 10,001, you punch it, enter, bang, bang, bang. It will say, no, sorry, there is a kind, you cannot punch above 10,000. 5,000 and 6,000, you can punch. But 10,000 above, you cannot punch. But same party, same day, 5 plus 6, 11, can you punch? Again, you can have additional control. So control has to be actually improved also over a period of time. So that is called application control. So application control shall include all three except. So one is not an application control. What is it? Application control are a subset of internal control, correct? Because internal control is omnipresent, general control, administrative control, and application control. Okay, so therefore, application control is a subset of internal control. A is an answer, not an exception. Purpose of the application control is to collect timely information, reliable information. Yes, that is also answer is correct. Therefore, it is not an exception. So, answer should be CRD. It is part of IS auditor responsibility. Wrong. IS auditor and control. IS auditor will check whether control is there and find out whether control is working. Find out whether control is effective. He is not. It is not the person responsibility to implement it. So C is wrong answer. 31C. No PAN. As per Income Tax Act, the banking norms, all fixed deposit holders need to submit PAN or Form 60. Okay, or 61. The bank in its account opening form, bank not updated the need for Form 60 in case PAN is not there. In PAN is not there, you have to ask for Form 60. That is a declaration that I don't have taxable income. Okay. This defines control labs as per COBIT, control objective for information technology. Okay. So this is a COBIT objective. It is a control labs. Okay. At the entry level itself, it is not asking. It is there in many banks, many things are like this. Okay. That's a very practical question. 100% practical question. Now, this defines control labs as per source. This is a very, very important question. Source data preparation and authorization. Source data collection and entry. Okay. And accuracy, completeness, and authenticity check. And processing integrity and validity. So So source processing integrity and validity, I don't process at all. Entry panla, where is processing? So D is not answer. Accuracy, completeness, and authenticity check. So where accuracy, you have not entered data at all. Then only accuracy, completeness will come. So naturally source data. Source data, collection, and entry. You are not collected at all. Then there is a question of entry. Okay. Source data, preparation, and authorization. So this preparation means, when the source data is prepared, give me PAN, give me 60. That place itself, control is lapse. Once you have the prepared data, then you have to enter. Prepared data itself is not there. So therefore, A is the, which is the control lapse? Is it data entry or data preparation? It is data entry. But the same question, ulta I will put. Ulta I will put. Look at this. Here, is it data preparation or data entry? You have to be very careful. In a public sector bank, while mastering, while updating master data, for advances given, the bank employee does not update insurance data. Because insurance, you have to take the copy and you have to enter the date of insurance taken, when it will expire, and it should inform and all this stuff. So they don't update insurance data. Once one time insurance has been put, when you do the audit at that time, they will say, what is the insurance expired? No, sir, already we have the latest data, latest insurances. Then you have not updated. Then what is the problem here? That means you have source data. Source data is there, but it is not entered. It is not entered. So here B is the answer. So 33, B is the answer. Collection and entry. Collection also you have done. Entry does not update. You have entered data because original data is there. So that is why entry is also correct. You have collected and entry, original data is there. Then what is it? The completeness and accuracy is not there. So because originally data is entered, that is there. That means insurance data is there, but that is not complete or accurate. Why? You have the latest insurance is also there, but that is not updated. That is not updated means, so you have the latest insurance, but that is not updated. But insurance data is entered, insurance collected, entered. So data prepared, collected, and everything is there, but it is not accurate. So C is your answer, 33C. Okay. Please be careful. Please be careful. And I wish to hear from two or three participants maximum before I close for today's session. May I request anybody who has raised your hand I will ask them to unmute and then share your thoughts. Okay. So may I request, we have a friend from, anybody has, I will ask Mr. Vijay Kalmicherla. Vijay Kalmicherla, can you just unmute yourself, please? We will hear your view, and we'll also hear from another person from, we'll find out. We'll ask Mr. Natarajan. Good morning, Mr. Natarajan. After Mr. Vijay, we'll ask Mr. Natarajan to speak. Mr. Vijay?
Hello, sir.
Very good morning, Mr. Vijay. So, can we have your...
Hey, good morning, sir.
Can we have your reflections, please?
Exactly. The session is excellent. We are failing this analysis quarter way. Two answers look similar. Where I went wrong, I am analyzing based on your analysis. It's very clear. Fundamentally, going through the study material is most important, as you suggested, which we are not doing.
Okay. So,
you very clearly explained where we are failing.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Vijay. Yeah? Thank you, Mr. Vijay.
Really good system.
Gopakrishnaraju, I am Prasanna Kumar here. I'll just take a minute.
Please, sir.
Yeah, because I had to join some other meeting. Yes, sir. So, friends, when I was addressing, some queries have been put in the chat box. I'll just quickly answer them, then log off. There were queries like, you know, whether ET is not yet qualified, will it be in old syllabus or new syllabus? The old syllabus for both ET and AT, eligibility test and assessment test will be there for 3 attempts. So ET, already one attempt is over in the month of May. For AT, the first attempt will be in the month of August. Thereafter, 2 more attempts will be there. After 3 attempts, either ET old syllabus, new syllabus, only the ET and the AT both will be new syllabus only.
So, this, only,
అండ్ in 2005 and 2014 I passed my ET. What will be the syllabus? The answer is already I told you. Another two more attempts it will be there. Then comes whether Tirumaleswaro is asked whether the eligibility for the empanelment weightage, can it be postponed? That is the query he has put it. The query is not clear, but I'll tell you the eligibility, what has been put in the Reserve Bank of India recent guidance in the month of April, even otherwise also, they will not be postponed because it's there already. It's not something new which has come now. Already we've got 27,000 charter accounts who have qualified this also. And the last question is whether ET can be conducted before the August month AT. Actually, friends, the ET is there only two times in a year. That is in the month of May and November. AT is month of June and December. Thereby, the next ET will be in the month of November. However, looking at the some requests made by the members and also the pandemic situation which we underwent during the month of May, many could not participate. Only close to 1,500 members of party underwent this eligibility test, out of which I think 72% have passed also. So I'll make a request to the committee to see that one more ET is conducted in between so that they'll have ample time to appear in the AT, which will be conducted in the month of December. So with this, Gopal Krishna Raju, so I just want to share this information.
So nice of you, sir.
Thank you. So nice to see Kalim Cherla also speaking today. He's a very dynamic personality in Hyderabad. Vijay. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much. Thank you, sir. We'll also now hear from another past chairman from Salem. Mr. Natarajan, you are there, sir. Can we have your input?
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for arranging such a beautiful analytical seminar, classes, not seminar, for the sake of the members. We wanted to get knowledge about technology. Actually, I have passed ET in 2002 itself. I have not written the exams for that. I joined because you asked me to join in this. For the sake of you, I joined, but I'm getting more information about it and recall everything. I'm really thankful to you, and also I thank all the branches who joined together, that all Andhra branches. It's a beautiful one. Actually, that we used to tell in Tamil, Selvathul Selvam Savi Selvam. When we hear, we make more information rather than studies, because interpretation will be different between person to person. Really thankful for introducing me in the group. Thank you, Raju. But as usual, you are always like a player. Always you will be the first.
Thank you. Now over to Guntur Executive Committee members for the closing remarks.
Thank you very much, sir. As usual, you rock the session. I would like to give a small clarification to all the members. As today was the first first day of this course of 6 days, little time has gone for the formalities. So from tomorrow, we'll start the session at 8:20 a.m. So that from 8:30, we'll have a session from 8:30 a.m. till 10:30. And we would like to close by 10:30 or maybe mostly by 10:35. Because for almost all the members, there might be pre-schedules already as we are conducting morning session. If it would have been in the evening, we would have extended time. So sorry for the people who have asked for the extension of the session. Thank you very much. Now I request our Ongole branch chairman, Rajendra Prasad sir, to give his closing remarks and vote of thanks also. Thank you.
Morning all of you. Friends, it is my proud privilege to propose vote of thanks for this August gathering. First of all, on behalf of Guntur branch of SIRC of ICA and Ongole, Anantapuram, Kadapa, Kakinada, Karimnagar, Warangal, Rajahmundry, Tirupati, Vishakhapatnam, Vijayawada and Kurnool branches, we express our sincere gratitude to the today's program director, CAD Prasanna Kumar Garu, today's guest of honor, R. Changal Reddy Garu, RCM and expressive member of Guntur branch, today's faculty, CA Gopal Krishna Raju Garu, senior faculty, CA Dr. Paul Jaikar Garu, who is guru for many of our members, senior members and professional colleagues for accepting our invitation, sparing your valuable time and addressing our members during this seminar. CA Gopal Krishna Raju Garu has presented the entire subject in a lucid and quick manner, He has covered many new questions and enlightened session. All members are still, majority of the members are still present, which shows the subject is very interesting. From Ongol branch, we specially thank my good friend CA J. Srinivas Rao Garu, Guntur branch chairman, CA Maddi Raviteja, secretary of Guntur branch, for arranging such a big program and involving many of the Telugu speaking branches in this mega event. Chairman and MC members from all the 13 branches, delegates from 66 branches who have participated from various parts of the country. I think for the first time for Ongol branch, Guntur branch staff, professional colleagues and all others for making this CPE seminar a grand success. Thank you Ananda. Jai Hind, Jai ICA. Hey. Over to Secretary Guntur branch.
I request everyone to be attending the session by 8:20 a.m. tomorrow morning. Thank you.